Ladies and gentlemen, one of the things that I am beginning to ask that we as a university community pride ourselves on is creating a space for all ideas, all shades of views to be reflected. And as we designed this Turkeyen Tain Talks, I invited Dr. Mohammed. I said, let's see if we can get the Minister of Finance, and let's see if we can get, on the other side, the spokesman from the opposition to come and share their views. I'm delighted that our Minister of Finance, after a long cabinet day, thought it useful to join us, and so please give a rounding welcome to you.
Country that's been able to draw significant international resources and so on. But in the goodly honorable minister's budget, I think it was there, but in 2 days ago or so, on reading it yesterday, I had the impression that he copied my 2017 budget. There you saw a GCT there, which you call a general consumption tax. As you know, we got rid of ours because the consumption tax tends to go on final goods and not tax it as you add value. They have a general consumption tax that is 16.5%. We just lowered ours from 16 to 14%. They have just put GCT on things like health services, increased the gasoline tax, and a whole range of taxes on food. You could read it, it's in the Daily Gleaner. And of course, they have the usual pushback. You know, the private sector has gone up and been jumping high and jumping or railing back. And I wasn't as brave as my colleague in saying we will not be doing anything. I perhaps did it a little more diplomatically and such. But the issue here is not that Guyana don't like the private sector. It's not that Guyana don't like civil society. It's not that Guyana don't like the population of Guyana. That's where we're drawing our votes from. So how can we don't like this? It is that we have a country to run. Yes, 4,000 more people might have voted for this government than they did not for the opposition. But we can't be a government for the coalition. We have to be a government for the people of Guyana. And in everything we do, we have to have the people of Guyana in our consciousness. Yes, we have different groups, different sectors of society and so on, but at the end of the day, we have to come up with a judicious mix of policies, a trade-off, so to speak, that at the end of the day, we have to have most, if not all, people satisfied, as opposed to some secular group being satisfied. We have to work with the private sector. They're an important partner. We have to work with the trade union. They're also an important partner. But having said that, those said groups also have to work with the government. And this, unfortunately for me, I do not see. You always hear how the government not working with the private sector. You always hear how the government not working with the unions. The unions are up to 48%. The government in paying 48%, therefore the government is not working with the trade unions. The private sector turns up at a meeting with me, and you have a long shopping list. A long shopping list. If you check any policy that you want to be implemented, say, United States, there are various groups, and there are studies, and there are numbers, and there's so on. So when they go to the Senate and the Congressional Budget Office and all the different places, they have their facts marshaled and they make their case. And so you have to go and make sure that you, the government, can make your case. And you have the cotton trust. It is based on empirical evidence. You know, not some wishy-washy thing which says, oh, if you lower taxes, then you will, if you lower tax on corporate tax, they don't collect greater taxes and all these kind of things. There are no numbers behind these things. And whenever you attempt to make a policy like that, you obviously shoot in the dark. Which Minister of Finance for the South will be able to make policy on something which says, you give me a long shopping list and we decide to negotiate, not on the premise of evidence, but on the premise of, well, I told you, give me five. You know? And you know, so when you try to get this over to the private sector, you hear how they went to see the Minister of Finance and they come back empty-handed. But the reality is, I cannot, in a slender tax base, attempt to be diminishing the tax base on a premise, on a prayer, that if I do it, I will get more. Then nothing is in front of me to convince me indeed I could go forward and take the plunge, even as I can swim. So, I like listening to Jerry, and I like listening to his comrades in the private. I don't have to call Guyana an active state. It is being called what it is. And I don't know that it means that you get less investment. Let's be very realistic about Guyana. It's a natural resource-based country. We have the natural resources. And whether you call it narco or any old, as long as they want the natural resources, they will come. And that's why Exxon is here. That's why you have Oma here. That is why you have Goldfields here. And that's why you have Baishanlin here and all the rest of it. But they're not going to come, say, in agriculture. They're not going to come, say, in your craft. They're not going to come in manufacturing. You're not competitive. They're not going to come. Your labor might be cheap, but it's not skilled. Your electricity is not cheap. Your roads are not there. Your education is not there. Your health services are not there. You don't even have port facilities. You know, when we talk about, oh, we were getting investment, and it's suddenly gone out. All right, let's look at that too. With the exception of the ERP years, Economic Recovery Program, that was implemented by Hugh Desmond Hunt, former president. When we were so low that anything thereafter, you would probably do. Growth returned back in 1991, 6.1%. Then in 1992, I think it was 7.4%. Then in 1993, I think it went to 8%, and then it started dipping. Until around 1997, I think thereabout, or somewhere around then it was 5.7%. But thereafter, we were back to what we knew. Growth was somewhere between 3 and 4%. And with all the investment that you were supposed to be having for the last 15 years, growth was still 3, 4%. So it's not a case as if when this government came in, we suddenly did something and growth started slowing and so on. This economy starts slowing since 2014. Let's be honest and realistic. It starts slowing since 2014. You know why? Because the luck that we were enjoying, the luck that we were enjoying in the previous years, ran out. It wasn't a sustained economy. The luck, you may ask, what was it? The luck that we were enjoying premium prices in Venezuela for us. Prices that way above world market price. And we made the same mistake with rice that we made with sugar. When we got a premium market price, instead of we convinced the farmers to ensure your cost is just equal to the world market, we allow them to, we continue to subsidize them, allow them to plant dams and everywhere else, marginal lands and everything, to go after a premium price. But we all knew that premium price went to us. And unfortunately for us, by the time we got in there, the bottom fell out. So there goes rice production. Sugar. We were warned as far back as I went to Mauritius in 1988, April. And we were warned since then that the sugar price was not going to last forever. We were warned by the EEC, used to call them in those days. And we made a lot of noise. Oh, it's inviolate. Oh, it's this. Oh, it's that. And so on. And while we were making noise, Mauritius, we didn't learn any lesson from Mauritius. Mauritius had refused to pay their farmers the premium price that they were getting. That the government were getting. Instead, what they did is to take the market price, and then they gave them an adjustment. The rest they used for economic development of the country. Here, we made a tug of war over it. We took some in levy, and we took a lot of it in increased wages and incentives and all these different things. Today, the sugar price has fallen out, and sugar itself has fallen out. Now become a net. Net loser of our next generation. Timbo, we got lots of investment in Timbo. Oh, we got Baishanlin, we got Baitarno, we got all these other different people. And what did they do? They come and the lucky you caught them while we caught them. Because when you looked and see what had happened in that short space of time, it was like a desert. All the logs were being cut and then go. So I don't know whether we wish to continue along that line. I'm not talking about that other big sea. that is related to narcotics, which Professor Thomas has done a lot of work in, and which he has been able to convince us that indeed that is what was fueling this economy. But I do not know how long we as a country expected to have continued along that road and A, gain the respectability of our League of Nations, and B, sustain growth in this economy. You can't take off, you cannot take off on bases that are as malleable as we have been. We have to build firm bases, then to enjoy the takeoff. And this, unfortunately, has been left to this government to do. It's not going to happen overnight. I'm not going to promise people it's going to happen overnight. And it's not going to be painless. Barbados was the epitome of a well-run economy. Who would have believed Barbados would have been what it is today? I don't know that they did anything spectacularly wrong. But we are little small countries trying to exist, swimming in big oceans. And we're not being given favors. We have to be able to do it for ourselves and exhorting that we survive. But look at Barbados today. Barbados have done what I consider to be one of the best things. They have now courted the former Prime Minister, Mr. Guyana, as their chief economic advisor. And before he could even turn on Thursday, he said, listen, we have to stop what we're doing. These are not his correct words, but this is the gist of what he's saying. We have to tell the Barbadians the truth. And the truth is that to get back where we were or where we want to go will require heavy adjustment. It will require a lot of pain. And since they don't want to devalue, it will require, he didn't say this, but I'm saying to you, since they don't want to devalue, it will require even more pain than you will normally do. I don't know the Trinidad, yes, that you know, did anything spectacularly wrong. Yes, they wasted a lot of their money and so on, but they still have a lot in their heritage fund and so on. But Barbados has grown, Trinidad has grown by negative something in the region of 8-9%. And they've been in recession for how many quarters? Governor lost his job. Governor lost his job in Barbados. My friend in Suriname used to be the governor of Suriname, he's now the Minister of Finance. I was there with him when he was in Washington a couple weeks ago, with the IMF trying to negotiate a less severe program that they have to go through. And they have been growing negative. We know what's going on in Venezuela, or Brazil, we know what is going on. Jamaica is growing by 0.2%. And they were clapping when they said this year they were almost going to make 1%. No, because sometimes we behave as if the sky is falling. You know, I all remember the story about chicken. Right? The sky is falling. Oh, this is happening again. Oh, this is happening again. And yet we don't A, want to understand where we came from. B, what we inherited. You know, like I said, the program yesterday. I read somewhere where somebody said, oh, this government talking about how much money they're giving to sugar. You know, the previous government was also giving money to sugar. Maybe true. But there are two things that the previous government was doing. They weren't giving sugar the amount of money that we have to find today. $12 billion in 2015, another 11 last year. We have 9 this year, but we're not too sure how long that will go. Because we don't give $3 billion already for January, and they ask for 3 more for February. So we're not too sure how long that is worth. But let's say toward 2 billion, that's just in transfers. And all that $200 billion that was used and scaled on, it is this government that got to pay for it, rather than they paying us so that we can pay back their loans for it. You must know these things. Because when you ask for 48 and 50% and we have to put more taxes, you must know why we have to do it. Because if we had $32 billion available, that we were not given to that super. Just think about what we could have done with it. Perhaps we wouldn't get the base on back that we had to put in last. And if that super was paying us like they were supposed to do, so that we could pay back the debts that they contracted for Skeldon, we wouldn't have had to find that money. Just think what we could have done with that kind of money. Just think what it would have meant to teachers, public servants, infrastructure, and so on. The reality is, we could pull back every tax you want us to pull back and hope that the economy will grow based on what you tell us. And we could pull back every tax that we put in. But we have to do something else on the supply side. We have to get rid of people. We will have to cut programs, including social programs. Nothing can be sacrosanct. In all of this discussion, all we at the government level plead for is understanding and rationality. We understand where every sector is coming from. They don't want another tax. And in many of these cases, it's not really a new tax. It's really enforcement of what should have been done a long time ago. Enforcement, for example, of concessions. When I give you concession, I expect that you said you can give me what in return, which is you can create jobs, you can add value, and so on. But in many cases, I'm not going to say most, in many cases, all you see added are vehicles. All you see added are vehicles. And then when you go finally get down to check-in, you got every excuse in the book. Why didn't add the sawmill yet? Why didn't add the value added part of it yet? And so on. And then they get legs and they pick up and they run. And then of course you have to let the private sector. Because we talk about it in here, you don't like it. You know, and you hear how to pull back and so on. But I love the private sector. And a number of my policies are going to be in favor of the private sector. It's just that they have to work with us so that we could get there. And we have started this year. Manufacturing. The tax on manufacturing has gone down, even below the individual income tax. Everybody coming in and saying that. The VAT has gone down from 16 to 14. And you should be picking up placards. You should be picking up placards and saying why I'm not, why is this past true not happening? And I hope Jerry will stand up here and say, yes, the government has done a couple of good things. And he's going to go back and talk to his private sector commission and tell everybody there who's not passing through the VAT reductions to pass it through. I would love him to say that. Because we have said that as part of our economic policy, we intend to reduce taxes. And we intend to have them lower than what we inherited them. And we've started this year. We have reduced income tax. You hear about taxes, taxes, taxes. We have reduced individual income tax. And nobody's even praising me for doing what I did on Treasury.
We praise you, Winston. We praise
you. I tell people, look, we're talking about destroying the middle class. You destroy the middle class with the type of tax regime that we had. When we came in 2015, all you were entitled was $50,000 as a tax. Like we used to call it free pay. They call it threshold. So if you work with $300,000, all you're entitled to is $50,000. And the rest taxed at 30%. In less than 2 years, what have we done? We're giving you one third. One third right away. As your no threshold. So right away you're entitled to 100,000 out of 300 to take over. And further, all your contributions of NIS are now discounted. So you have to take out all your contributions that you're making to NIS before you get to the tax. And then what you do? You force 120,000 of what is left back after you clear out all of that. It's now taxed at 28%. And then the little residual is then taxed at 40%. So of $300,000, essentially you're taking home anything like $40,000 per month. Per month. And you could do whatever you want with it. People don't like hear I say this about VAT. But lucky for you on VAT is, it only applies to you when you consume the service. So in a sense, it allows you to regulate your consumption patterns and your demand for the good. And don't tell me, well, you must do it, because Most, the bat does not fall in most tropical foods, and that base has been expanded. So for me, I know we don't have the whole night, but for me, what I'm pleading for is understanding. And to understand, you have to read and make certain that you don't follow the bunch, so to speak. But you are able yourself to make a reasoned argument based on what has been put in front of you. Because in many ways, when you begin to question people and so on, oh, they haven't read it, they heard it say. Yeah. But I think primary sources of the information are the best sources. I'm not gonna knock the media and so on. No, I'm not gonna go down that road. But even up today, I have to call a certain media house and said, you know, just tell me where I have ever said something that you have read. And within 15 minutes, they call me back and apologize. You know, but you can't keep calling media every day to tell them, look, man, they're quoting you wrong, or they're ascribing to you things that you've never said, and so on. So sometimes you just have to leave it, but some of them are just too rigorous to, you know, just to let it slide, so to speak. So in this year, let me conclude by just indicating that I want to leave here on a present note and say that we are going to engage the private sector once again. When I left my office this afternoon, I was trying to set up a meeting with the Warbys, the Upper Quarantine and Warbys Chambers of Commerce. They invited me to go there, but unfortunately I won't be around. So I suggested an alternative date where we can meet and discuss a range of issues that they want to discuss. And I think we can again find common ground. Be prepared to meet any group. My door, I said, is a revolving door. You can call and come in. You don't have to wait until budget time. But please, let us engage in a conversation that is constructive, that for the most part is evidence-based, and let us sort of, we don't have to like each other, but we have to have mutual respect for each other. I want to thank you, and I hope we can enjoy the benefits of the visit. Thank you.
I know the minister would have gotten a bigger round of applause if he had said, the University of Guyana is going to get an extra $1 billion. Go ahead, minister, we can make that announcement.